Yes, we are right.
I think we're good to go. All right, all right. So thank you everyone for watching. This is the best way to support Bitcoin and to make sure it's strong every day. So we're here to discuss a lot of things, and feel free to drop your comments or questions in the chat. I'm Ricardo de Ross. I'm with the international expansion at Casa. And I would like to introduce Camila and Javier. They will make a quick intro of themselves.
Yeah, so my name is Camila Campton. I currently work with Swan Bitcoin doing community management, social media, and I also co-host a Spanish show with Javier. So love to talk about Bitcoin, and thank you for having me.
Nice to be here with you guys. As Camila said, we co-host a show. I also work with Swan, but with other different projects. I'm the organizer of Satoshi in Venezuela, that is a Bitcoin-only educational project born here in Venezuela in 2019. We are going through different phases of the idea of build a community around Bitcoin, because we started doing meetups, but now we are mainly in the internet and trying to push again the meetups, and that's what I'm doing right now.
Awesome, awesome. Thanks for being here, guys. And well, the main topic here is to talk about Bitcoin in the world, you know, how does it impact people and different contexts of countries, and especially developing countries. So we'll start off with a, you know, broad question. What is Bitcoin in developing countries? You know, from your experience, what do you hear from people? What your idea is of what people perceive Bitcoin to be in developing countries? Camila, can you start?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Actually, I would love Javier to start, since
he
lives in Venezuela right now and can give really good background.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Camila. Bitcoin is the way I can survive the disaster that is my country right now, because we are living through a dictatorship, a regime that is trying to paint themselves from the countries abroad, like if they are doing all this with a democratic approach or something like that, or all that is a charade. And we have, as citizens, really few freedom in the financial regard, so we are all forced to use the bolivar, that is the national currency, but also dollars in the inflationary logic in the bolivar. So it's, the bolivar is an hyperinflationary currency right now, but as it is the dynamic in the inner economy, the dollar is having really great issues to be the main dominant money inside the country. So in this kind of uncertain time, we have Bitcoin, that is, as I said, how I can survive this disaster. Well, through holding and earning an asset that can be controlled by the same government that is destroying the economy. And I see that I have a really large of different things that in common with different people that are in other countries, even in developing countries, because all is related to the capital controls that you can face. We are facing a harder capital control, that is through inflation and through the destruction of your time while you are working to earn that destroyed currency, but you have also this other monetary system that gave you the opportunity to save you from the more near disaster, but also in the global context. I think that I'm almost lucky to be one of the first people that are earning Bitcoin directly through my own work. So I think that it is a tool to survive the general disaster, the near disaster, and also to build yourself a kind of new of view over the world. Like, not everything hasn't to be a disaster. Like, we can have positive things. We can have a positive impact in our cities, in our communities, and well, that's what it means to me.
I love having Javier's perspective first, because he's living through a situation, right, that a lot of other countries are in danger of living as well, right? Because no fiat currency right now is safe from hyperinflation or from a government taking over and just completely destroying everything. So it's really amazing to see Javier's point of view in a country where they're already living that, but that other countries still haven't woken up to the idea that this can happen to you as well, right? So from personal experience, I have family in Colombia. I'm Colombian, and I'm the one that brings up Bitcoin all the time to them, right? Because how can I not? And to them, they start talking about, well, Bitcoin, is it a Ponzi scheme? You know, is it just something that you invest in or trade? Like, they still haven't wrapped their heads around the idea that they should be looking for something hard, solid money where they can take cover or refuge if something happens in Colombia, like what happened in Venezuela. Right. So I think we're still really, really early in the education phase of what Bitcoin can become for these countries. But it's a really exciting time because, like Javier said, you don't have to get to that point in order to start suffering the consequences of the government and the money printing that's going on all over the world. You can start taking action now and protecting yourself before any of that happens.
Yeah, and that's a very interesting point, because each country is in a different stage, right? So Venezuela is a more extreme case, so people feel it and they want to take action to protect themselves. So Bitcoin is a great way. But like Colombia or Brazil, for example, the economy, of course, there is inflation. The economy is not great, but it's more stable, let's say. So people don't really look at Bitcoin yet as a way to protect themselves. In Brazil, for example, the feeling that people have is that Bitcoin is a way to get rich or to make money or whatever. In Argentina, on the other hand, you know, there's a little bit of that, but there is also protection against inflation because their currency is devaluing faster. So they protect themselves in the US dollar, and Bitcoin became also an alternative. So each country is in a different stage. And like Camila said, education is key. You know, as long as people keep thinking that it's just an investment, just something to make money, then they don't realize what's behind Bitcoin, what Bitcoin really is. So this is important. And tied into that, also the perception that Bitcoin is for the rich, you know, like, oh, some friends ask me, oh, so how much is a Bitcoin when I talk about it? Oh, it's like, now it's $40,000. So, oh my God, that's not for me, you know, $40,000. They don't realize you can buy fractions, you can, you know, it's a long process that you can get involved and do. So what's your perception of that? You know, some people think that it's for the rich, but actually it's more for the poor than the rich. So your thoughts on that?
I never holded a whole Bitcoin, and it is like my commitment to work hard enough to hold one Bitcoin. So I think that I'm the main example of how it is not for the rich, just for the rich. It is even for normal people like me. I'm not a cryptographer. I'm not an engineer. I came from the human science. I'm a philosopher. So I don't have anything related to Bitcoin and how Bitcoin works, but I learned how it works and learned how to use it in this context and learn how to save money, because if you earn money, you can save some money, and you can save the time you spend to earn that money in something that is harder than the options that you have in your hands. So if I could learn all this, I think that anybody could learn it too, because I'm not a special guy at all. It is just different things that I made, like writing things about Bitcoin, writing news, and that stuff make me understand and make me to really understand why Bitcoin matters, how it is useful. And I think that all the people can do the same thing in all the conditions that you could have, because if you can't earn enough money to save or to have a stable internet connection, Bitcoin won't save you. That is it couldn't do it. Because that's not why it was created. But if you have at least those minimum conditions,
you can use it as Michael Saylor does. The difference is that he's a billionaire, I'm a poor guy, but we can use it. It is open for both of us. So it is for anybody that is willing to take it and use it.
Yeah, I think that's a story that only the privileged get to stack sats. And that's something that we have to completely turn over its head, because it's not about privilege. It's about how this is a permissionless system that you don't need to ask anyone for permission in order to start stacking Satoshis. You know, some people in developing countries, they don't even have a bank account. So it's like, how are they even, you know, saving their money under the mattress? Like, that is not a very safe place to do so. So, you know, we have to start educating people that you don't have to have a whole Bitcoin to start off. You know, those times are over, but we have Satoshis and they're just as valuable as having a Bitcoin, right? It's not like, oh, in order for you to have all of the freedoms that Bitcoin provides you, you have to have one Bitcoin. No, if I stack just 10 Satoshis, I have the same permissions and the same freedoms as someone that has one whole Bitcoin. And I think this goes back to the narrative that we see on Twitter a lot. It's like, oh, you get in for the gains. You get in because you want to become rich, but you stay for other different reasons. And that wealth that you're going to generate, that wealth, right? Because it's different for every single person. The cool thing about it is that it doesn't matter if you have millions of dollars in Bitcoin or just $10 in Bitcoin, you're already storing something that can be for generations to come. And if you start developing the discipline, like Javi said, in order to be saving money, if you're able to, then start saving your money in Bitcoin. If you don't have a way to save money, you can start learning about ways that you can earn in Bitcoin. You know, like, there's a lot of opportunities out there. Javi is a perfect example. He's earning Bitcoin all the way from Venezuela, working for other companies from around the world. So we need to stop having these mental barriers that, oh no, Bitcoin is not for me because I don't have money. No, Bitcoin is for you. Just try to find the way to see how you can get access to it and start building on top of that and start educating yourself. That's how we break these mental barriers. Because when you start educating yourself and you start to see the proposition that Bitcoin has for you, since it's very different for people all over the world, you're going to want to share that with everyone else as well. And that's how adoption starts. So all that negativity about how Bitcoin is only for the Americans and the privileged and that have money, it's not true. Bitcoin is for absolutely everyone.
Agree 100%. And well, you touched on like unbanked people and also on earning Bitcoin. So before we were talking about, you know, saving money only. So Bitcoin as an asset that you can store value in, and then earning and using it in transactions is another way of using Bitcoin. So your thoughts on that, you know, Bitcoin as a medium of exchange, and are we there yet? That's actually the question behind it, because while the price of Bitcoin is volatile, it's high, and so on. So how do people take advantage of Bitcoin for transactions?
I think that it is a really interesting topic to see, because if you think in the dollar, I'm in a country that its own currency is destroyed, so we are trying to avoid that destruction, flying to the dollar. But I can use the dollar easily. I don't have an American account. I just have one bank account here in Venezuela, and my bank is shitty as fuck. I don't trust the banks inside the country. So even when they can offer some kind of dollarized services, I'm not feeling so confident to keep, I don't know, more than $50. $100, and I think that I'm in really danger. And that's the situation with the dominant monetary system in the world, that is the dollar, and I can't use it even when I need it. So Bitcoin, on the other hand, it is a bank and also a money, so I can store the money with all the functions of a bank, because I can find a loan against the money that I have. I can sell it for other currencies to cover my expenses and all the stuff. But I don't have the problems that I may have with the banks and using dollar banks, because it is difficult to have a bank account if you're a Venezuelan. It is the reality right now. So I'm using Bitcoin to cover all those functions. I'm not saying that everybody will do that, but I think that if it is possible to me, it is possible to anybody that expends the time to learn how to do it. And the volatility is something that I'm familiar to, because my currency is always volatile in the negative way. It is always losing value, like the words of the shit coins. And so as I'm seeing that, and I'm excluded of the dollar system to use it in a more efficient way, only if I have physical cash dollars. But that's a problem, because if I have a 20 bill and I want to spend only, let's say, $12, they will say, hey, I can give you the $8. So you have to consume the whole bill. And all those barriers are saved with Bitcoin. So when you understand that, maybe you can combine this with the stable coins. That is another thing that is really useful and popular right now in Venezuela. USDT is like the dollar from the people that is in my situation, excluded from the dollar. But at the end, you are having the same thing that you will, the same problems that you will have holding dollars, of financial dollar, banked dollars, instead of these crypto dollars, that is the inflation and it losing its power by the years. So if you are in a position that you have, you are earning enough money like to save something, it makes really sense living through this kind of situation that you could find in Nigeria, in Turkey, in Argentina, in Venezuela. It makes really sense to see Bitcoin as at least a tool to save something that is harder. Like when my grandfather see like the gold as a good idea to hold instead of only dollars or only bolivars, well, now we have Bitcoin instead gold. It is a good idea if it pops up and finally being a good thing. So from any perspective that you try to see, if it's an investing, it is a safe money, I don't know, from any perspective that you see it in a context like this, it will be really easy to at least buy 1,000 Satoshis.
I think the whole debate of whether Bitcoin is, what is Bitcoin? Is it property? Is it a medium of exchange? It's very interesting, but you have to kind of look to see, like, people are using it as a medium of exchange. So to your question, like, are we there yet? It depends who you are and where you are in the world, because people are already using it as a medium of exchange. So we had the pleasure of going to El Salvador and to see what's going on in Bitcoin Beach. And it was really cool talking to the locals that are, you know, are accepting Bitcoin as payment. Their, you know, their transactions are basically in Bitcoin. And I was very curious, because I was like, are these people only using it as, you know, a medium of exchange, or how else do they view Bitcoin? So there's a very famous little cart that sells shaved ice. They have like the little Bitcoin logo in their cart. And their story was super inspiring to me, because they said, we had to start this business because we got fired from our other jobs. And so we started selling the shaved ice. And when we saw that we could accept Bitcoin, and when we were taught to use Bitcoin, we just started adopting it right away. And so I asked them, well, do you just use it, or do you save it? And they said, well, you know, whatever we have, our earnings will pay for our basic stuff, and then the rest of it we'll actually save, because we understand that this is a long-term thing. So they really understand that, you know, if you need to eat, use your Satoshis. Like, you can't be like, oh, I don't have dollars, I only have sats, I only have to save them, so I can't eat. No, there's people that need to use Satoshis in order to pay for their living, for their services, for their child's education. So for the people that that are doing that, I completely agree. It is totally a medium of exchange. If they're using it, yes. If other people view it as property, then good for you. It just really depends on where you are in the world, what your life is. And I think that's the beautiful thing, that there are no rules that say, no, it's just property. So you can't use Bitcoin to buy foods or groceries if you need to. And if you want it to be property, then fine. Just like keep it in cold storage forever and wait for the value to go up. But that's the beauty of Bitcoin. It's what you want it to be and what makes sense for your life.
Yeah, this is awesome. Bitcoin is freedom, right?
I want to add something there that sure. If you see that Bitcoin is to never spend, like you are a hodler forever and all this stuff, you are really privileged. You have a really great economic privilege. And also, probably your fiat system around you works at least good enough that you don't see a money that is decentralized, that don't have third-party problems. You don't see useful to spend? Well, that's because you are living a good life.
Yeah, and even in that case, you know, if people are just saving because they're in a good situation, whenever the need comes, it's there. They can transact. They can use it. So the Bitcoin has that freedom that you do whatever you want. You use it in any manner that makes sense for you in your context. So this is awesome. And Camila touched on El Salvador, which was going to be my next topic because you guys are really close to it. And it's awesome. Insights, of course, Camila talked a little bit about it. Javier, if you want to share something. But actually, the question I want to make is a little different from just the insights because it's very exciting what's happening. But It has two sides, right? It is awesome because there's a lot of adoption. People have access to it. People are learning about it. But on the other hand, it's like a government mandate. You know, the government took the initiative to do that, which could be good or bad. But some people criticize it, say, no, Bitcoin should be from the bottom up, not from the government down. So what do you think about that specifically? And I'll just add one comment that Obi from CoinFloor, he made in another session. He said, well, in Nigeria, when the government got involved and banned Bitcoin, that's when adoption exploded. So in his view, whenever government gets involved, that's the best way to educate people because then people will be aware and will try to learn more. And some other people think the opposite. Say, no, when government gets involved, that is bad for Bitcoin. So in the context of El Salvador, how do you guys see the situation?
I always said that I find it in a way contradictory with the idea that I have about Bitcoin, especially living in a situation that I have to use it and I choose it against what the government is doing to my money and my time. But in the other hand, you have this idea that it is so open, Bitcoin is so open that even a state could and will adopt it. The thing is when, not if. It is, as always we said, not if the governments, the banks, the companies and stuff will adopt it. They will. I'm not saying that they all be 100% in Bitcoin, but in some way, even offering services or I don't know, they will all adopt Bitcoin. So the state level adoption is something that will happen in different contexts. So in the case of El Salvador, you have this idea of a leader that they have a really big popular support that was elected by the enormous majority of the country and that is building the things that he finds that will be useful to build his own political view of what El Salvador will be. And it happens that in 2017, he was cut or was said that he will be cut out of the financial system inside El Salvador because he was trying to be mayor, I think. And he, in that moment, in 2017, said that he will be using Bitcoin. So this is not a thing that just happened to be in his mind. And he see Bitcoin as a tool that fits in his plan. So we don't know, as Bitcoiners, if Bukele is as hair-driven as many of us are, we don't really know, but as far as it is developing, we can say that it seems that it is trying to find ways to make a better El Salvador. So Bitcoin happens to be a tool in that project, and it also happens to be in the hands of a politician that have a really enormous amount of power inside his own country, almost rousing the limits of the democracy, and that's something that we should say, but it is all inside the democracy game yet. So you have this idea of it is a legal tender, a forced legal tender, but so is the dollar, so is the bolivar, so is every legal tender in other countries and all around the world. And maybe you can have a more specific way to phrase this seventh article in the law that is the more problematic. But at the end of the day, it is just stating the way that people could use Bitcoin inside the country. And in the next phase of what I think that is in the plan of Bukele with Bitcoin, you have the bonds that I think that is a really big deal, because it's the way that he find to finance this project that he's trying to build. And Bitcoin happens to be the way that he found to avoid the IMF that is trying to exclude them to have the financial. So you have all these things happening all at the same time, and all happening to people that at least knows the name of Bitcoin, but they don't really care. I mean, the Salvadorans, the majority of the Salvadorans, they don't really care about Bitcoin. Like, okay, it is cool. Maybe I could make a few dollars because they could be tourists in the country and all the stuff, but it is not affecting the normal life of Salvadorans, but exposing them to this knowledge, to all these ideas that we already discussed, to the tool itself. So it's really nice to see it. I think, as I said, it is contradictory, but with all this explanation, I could live in my contradiction.
I agree. You can understand why people are like, no, the way to adoption is grassroots on the way up. And you know what, guys? Like, it already happened. We can't do anything about it. It is what it is. Now we just have to be like, okay, this happened. How can we actually make this an amazing opportunity for the people in El Salvador and for the people across the globe? Because everyone is looking at El Salvador. I feel like Latin American countries are looking at El Salvador to see like, okay, what are they doing? Is this actually going to work? Is it not? So there may take some time before other countries maybe adopt Bitcoin in the same way, but we just have to make the best of it. You know, I think the biggest part is the education aspect. It would have been really great to see if before applying this law that pretty much scared a whole bunch of people, if there was a way that they could have gotten a lot more education on it so they could understand that, you know, it's not just that it's legal tender, but what are the opportunities that Bitcoin provides for you? And that's something that a lot of people are working on now, you know, and there's a lot of people that are super enthusiastic that aren't Salvadoran to be able to help educate. You know, that's our mission. That's our job as Bitcoiners. And so I see that this, as a positive thing, everything's good for Bitcoin. You know, like, this is good for Bitcoin. It's amazing for Bitcoin. People are getting exposed to it. There may come a time where another government steps in and they're like, you know what? We're taking out this law. Bitcoin isn't legal tender anymore. But guess what? The virus already infected the people there, and they're already going to be curious and are going to start using it. So it doesn't matter. You know, the fact that the law passed, I see it as a very positive thing. Because we see Bitcoin as a positive thing. You know, if it was another coin, I would have been like, this is the worst thing in the world. You know, they're just doing the same thing as the fiat system. But no, we're talking about Bitcoin. And we see like all of the potential of the benefits that Bitcoin has for people like people in El Salvador, which was a country that no one knew about. you know, before 2021. But now it's like this little country that's giving so much hope to so many people, even if they don't know it. So I see it as a positive thing. Doesn't mean that I'm a Bukele supporter and that, oh, I love the guy. You know, I respect the decisions that he has made, and I hope that he continues to make positive choices for his people. So we shall see what happens.
Awesome. Yeah. And my view on that is similar. It's like Bitcoin doesn't care. You know, I don't care about what the intentions were and how it was implemented. The big thing is that it was implemented, and Bitcoin is now accessible and in front of a lot of people that would not probably look at it. And this is very positive. Regardless of what happens politically, it's great. And now the whole world is watching to see what happens, right? So this is good too. And this, you know, good and bad things can come from the world watching. If it starts to work out well for El Salvador, maybe there will be some forces that will try to prevent it from expanding to other places. But Bitcoin doesn't care either. So the virus is there, like you said. great comments. One other thing that is important, like taking El Salvador as an example, a lot of people now have access, are exposed to Bitcoin, but I don't know all the details on how the people on the ground are using it, but worldwide, people don't really understand self-custody, which is one of the pillars of Bitcoin, right? To be self-sovereign and take care of your own wealth. And by wealth, it doesn't matter what amount of money it is. It could be $10 or $1 billion. But self-custody is an issue for Bitcoin overall because of lack of education, and people are looking, new people getting to Bitcoin because the price is rising and a friend made money or something like that in some places. In other places, because they need Bitcoin to transact or to store their money. So how is self-custody in developing countries in your view? And how can we improve that? How can we make more people be aware that holding your own keys is a good thing?
I think that the example of El Salvador is good to see this, because I think that this is a common in many different countries. Like, they are using Lightning wallets in the best case, because if not, they are using Chivo, that is a weirdly strange tool that is in the middle of the users. So you have your Bitcoin on Lightning, that is at least if you are running a node that I don't see that is the main user of Lightning, you are in some way letting your custody outside, because it is faster to use, it is more easy, and it have a lot of good things to choose it, but it have the trade-off of the self-custody. If you have, let's say, a way of make the people to understand the difference between Lightning and the Layer 1, and why it is important to, if you don't want to hold all your savings in Lightning, maybe it is a good idea to have that kind of money in the Layer 1. Why it is important to hold your own keys. And that I think that it is the tricky part, because even in the context of not having any confidence in the confidence in the banking system and not having confidence in your government, even in that scenario, you will always choose tools or path to use those tools that are easy. So that's why you have Binance being really popular here. We need the tool, we need to use it, but many people don't want to take the responsibility of using in a sovereign way. So I think that they will learn in a bad way. I don't know if it will be with Binance, but with other third-party services, because it is a matter of time. If Bitcoin grows so bigger, will be restricted for different users, and probably Venezuelans will be first in that list. So it will teach you in a hard way why it is important to hold your own keys. So we are trying to, as I said, I'm trying to push again the meetups. I organized a few in El Salvador, and the first meetup was about the keys and the idea of using different wallets, because it is critical to understand it, to better understand what is the value proposition of Bitcoin, and then you will build your own opinion of if it is useful or not to you. But I think that it has different layers of the discussion, and it is, I think, like in a third different level of the things that people will reach to understand. So it is still being a power user issue. It is a thing that the power users really discuss and are always trying to figure it out, but not for the most normie and normal user yet.
I think what we really need to teach people, and this is going to come out completely cheesy, but it's true, that with great power comes great responsibility. And when you own Bitcoin, you have a lot of power, and a lot of people don't realize that yet. The problem is, or not the problem, this is a feature, not a bug. What happens with Bitcoin is that whenever you make transactions, they're one, irreversible, right? So we need to let people know there is a chance that if you have Bitcoin on these on-ramps, or you have another person has custody of your Bitcoin, there is a chance that it can get hacked. They're going to go in there, make a Bitcoin transaction that's your Bitcoin, and send it somewhere else. And then what happens? Your Bitcoin's gone, right? It can happen. The only way that can't happen is if you actually have custody of your own Bitcoin and you're not allowing that transaction, right? So people just need to be aware of the risks that are going on. And they need to realize that Bitcoin is also trustless. You know, that's another feature of Bitcoin, that you don't have to trust, like Javi said, he doesn't have to trust the Bitcoin bank in Venezuela, right? He can just use Bitcoin in any way that he wants. If you're trusting other third parties, you've kind of missed the point of Bitcoin. So it's very important for you to learn the power that you have with this, that it can happen that maybe, God forbid, you have to run away from your country and you have to take your savings with you. How are you going to do that if a certain exchange blocks your account and you can't take your coins out? You know, like, you have to start thinking about these scenarios of start taking responsibility of owning, you know, owning the power that you have, protect it at all costs, and don't be like the people Javi said that are going to learn in a bad way about how important it is to actually have custody of your coins. And that's why we say, if it's not your keys, not your Bitcoin. Don't say that you have Bitcoin, that it's your Bitcoin, if it's in another place and not your own hardware wallet. And we have to start having these conversations with people. It can be scary. Yes. Impossible. No. You know, you just have to get used to it. Start teaching yourself. Start looking at YouTube videos. Talk to another Bitcoin that can help you out. Start with small transactions and then go on to bigger transactions. It's scary, yes, but at the same time, it's probably the coolest thing ever to see that you have that power to just take custody of your wealth in that way. So we should be encouraging it, and just start having more of these conversations. And the way that Javi's doing it in meetups is an absolutely amazing way. And people are starting to use other platforms to talk about this as well. Clubhouse, Twitter Spaces, what you guys are doing here right now, right? Showing people the power that it has. So this is a problem, yes, but I feel like if we start talking about it more and just teaching other people, that we can solve this. We just need to show people how important it is.
Awesome. I'll have a couple more questions, and then we'll go to questions from the audience to mix it up a little bit. One thing is not even a question, but what would be your recommendation for people in developing countries to get started with Bitcoin? People that are curious and they heard about it, but they never touched it. DCA, small purchases, accepting as payment, remittances, whatever makes the most sense for people to get started with. With the less amount of risk in their mind, because a lot of people don't get into Bitcoin because they think it's risky, you know, they're afraid or something. So what's the best approach for those people to get in?
I think that it will depend on where you are, because, for example, in Venezuela, in your Argentina, Colombia, Chile, P2P markets are really common and P2P platforms, but even P2P ways to exchange with a platform behind you, because as I said at the beginning, it is almost competing with all different currencies in the country. It is not like only an investing way of using it, but also a way to move capital, so to, or to avoid controls, or simply to exit from a more inflationary currency. But if you don't have this in mind, you only a general suggestion, I think that you can start just asking the friend that is trying to or spilling you to send you a few sats and experimenting with wallets, different level of wallets. I don't have only one recommendation of wallets, because you have to feel comfortable with using that. So you have to test different wallets and let's add from one wallet to another, and then trying to delete and recover the wallet when you are using a layer one wallet. But it all will depend on and relies on who is teaching you and where are you being taught. Because I don't think that you will find useful a Telegram bot that we are building, that is a LMP, yes, LMP2P bot, that is a chat bot in Telegram, which you can use to exchange fiat from sats in a P2P way. I don't think that many people in developed countries will find it useful, but it's a way that we, in this kind of situation, have find a easy way to onboard different people that reach us to trying to learn more about Bitcoin. And they say, well, I already know. I want to have some sats. And which is the best way to obtain those without you having to sign up in a KYC system. If you can avoid it, at least from the very beginning of your experience in Bitcoin, it will be better. If you have the lucky to have a Bitcoin ATM in your city, it is a good way to obtain your first sats. But I think that the recommendation at the end is try to avoid KYC platforms at the beginning and make your decision on using these kind of systems when you already know what kind of information you are exposing, why, if there is not a better option and all the stuff.
Yeah, I think Javi touched in a really, really good point of, and that this is something that a lot of Bitcoiners don't have, I guess, the privilege of knowing about, is that you don't have to give your information in order to acquire Bitcoin. Like, it comes, that's also like the privacy aspect, that it's another complete rabbit hole. But yeah, finding peer-to-peer places, which they are available. If you Google and you Google, where can I buy Bitcoin in Colombia? It's going to give you options and tell you which ones are KYC and non-KYC. So it's just before actually buying, doing your own research to see what you're comfortable with and what you aren't comfortable with in order of acquiring your first Bitcoin. And that kind of goes into like how, I'm sorry, I'm seeing a question, like how does Bitcoin protect people when it is difficult or impossible to extract money safely from exchanges without government oversight? And you know, it's just that there are places that you don't have to give your information away in order to acquire the Bitcoin. That's probably the best way to go. And that people have been doing it a lot around the world already in order to escape countries or, you know, other very difficult situations. So just getting educated on where the best place to get your Bitcoin, whether you want to give your information or not, it's probably a very big piece of advice that I wish I would have known before starting.
Yeah, and also this question that you just mentioned, you know, how to extract money safely from exchanges without government oversight. So it depends on your definition of money, right? So if you keep your Bitcoin then you know there's no oversight. You can take it anywhere you want. But if you're talking about fiat money, then you have to find you know alternatives that are not KYC'd and so on. And especially in places that are like dictatorships or that have super tight controls, then it is a challenge, of course. But having your Bitcoin with you is much better than having it at an exchange, of course. So that's the main thing for that question. And you know, let's bring up another one then. So the other question is that we mentioned Venezuela, Colombia, Argentina, El Salvador as well. So the person is curious to know how Bitcoiners are converting into fiat in South America in general. What are the on and off ramps? Well, my part of the answer is most countries do have exchanges tied into the banking system. So, you know, KYC and so on, that you can go through that route. But there are many other options, as Camila and Javier were speaking about, like P2P. But go ahead, Camila and Javier, please. Other options, how people are taking money off of exchanges or other places.
P2P markets are really popular in the region. I think that's the main way that people are exchanging their fiat to Bitcoin, and it is mainly dominated by Binance. Binance is doing a really huge work and a really huge effort to being the platform to use to go from the users that are trying to find P2P liquid markets, because that's the main thing in this kind of markets. If you have the liquidity, it doesn't matter what is the name of the platform. There will be the users trying to exchange fiat for Bitcoin and the other way. And they also have Tether, that is a main way that people is trying to onboard themselves into Bitcoin. Buying some Tether that at the end of the day it is a crypto dollar. And if you are being excluded of the ways to buy dollars, for example, in Argentina, you can only buy, I think that are $200 a month. You will find ways to acquire those dollars that you need. And at the end of the day, it all remains on how confident you are on the platform and how many liquidity it has. So you have other markets like Bitso in Mexico, that it's really big. It is a really big company in Latam, but they are not so popular in different countries because they don't have the confidence of the public, the users. So you have these different options to buy your Bitcoin in a P2P way. And I think that at least in Latin America, those are the key ways, because you have more old communities like in Argentina that they have P2P in real life ways to exchange. They have something that is named cuevas, like it's like caves. They're related to the name, like it is a horrible site where you are going to do bad things with your money and all this stuff. And they all have this way to exchange the fiat for Bitcoin. But it all depends on where are you.
You're also going to start seeing a lot of other banks say that they're going to be offering ways for you to buy Bitcoin and then converted to fiat. We're starting to see this in Colombia with all the different sandbox projects that they have, and that exchanges like Binance are partnering with major banks where people will have access to buy Bitcoin, and I'm guessing also exchange it for fiat. So we're still very early in the adoption, but I'm pretty sure other things are going to start popping up as adoption starts to explode even more. There's going to be a lot of more off ramps where people can exchange their currency how they want.
Yeah, and the ideal world would be to not need on or off ramps, right? If the world starts to use Bitcoin and you can actually use it without having to convert, that would be the ideal scenario, maybe in a few years, hopefully. And talking about scenarios in the future, another question here brings up the point that if Bitcoin continues to go up in price, even hyper Bitcoinization, the existing mega rich will buy it at exorbitant fiat price, let's say $5 million per Bitcoin. What will this do when 90% of the world still won't have any Bitcoin? So basically, price goes up. A lot of people, well, some people get a lot of Bitcoin and pay whatever it is, and then 90% of the population is left out. That's the scenario that they're describing.
I think that it is a game that is already happening. You have to stack as most sats as you can. If you really think that Bitcoin will thrive and that is a thing that really is important to have in the future that we are facing, but if you see the context we are talking right now, it will be really useful to have Bitcoin. So it will depend on how faster you can start to learning how to earn them or buying them. I think that earn is the best way to acquire your Bitcoin, because you are just KYC it with the people that is paying you if you are an employee, but if you are a freelancer, nobody have your anything about how you are earning those sats. But I think that Bitcoin can fix that, you know, like if you are left behind because you think that is a Ponzi, it is a scam, it is worse than the gold. I don't know, you are Peter Schiff and you're never gonna buy. You will pay the price you need to pay when it becomes not optional, but a need to be part of the financial new system that could be built. I don't see Bitcoin being that restricted because of the protocol, just because of the price. But well, it will depend on how fast you can start to build your stack.
I think this is a really interesting question, because the way I see it, it's kind of framed like only the rich are going to get it, and then they're just going to hold on to it and, you know, not exchange it. And that's why I love what we were talking about earlier, that yes, people are going to use it as a middle of exchange. So it's going to start dispersing across the whole globe, in my opinion. People that have a lot of Bitcoin will start to build other companies or other opportunities to help people, you know, work and start earning Bitcoin. You should start demanding that you want to start earning in Bitcoin, you know, and that's the beauty of it, is that, like I said, even if you have a lot of Bitcoin, you have a little bit of Bitcoin, the beauty of it is that no one's messing with it. No one's going to print more Bitcoin. No one's going to devalue your money, you know? So people... That's what happens in the adoption curve. There's always going to be, you know, the early adopters, then the curve goes, and then it's like the late adopters. But I feel like we're going to come to a world where everyone's going to have access to it. Everyone has access to Bitcoin right now. So thinking that, oh, this is only going to be for the super rich and that people are going to be left out, Bitcoin's going to come around to everyone at a certain point. Maybe it's in 100 years. Who knows? It doesn't matter. But that's the beauty of it, that whenever Bitcoin does reach your life and you are able to have some Satoshis, you know, to take advantage of it, to see that there's still power in those small Satoshis and that you can start accumulating more, earning more. And that's what we hope as Bitcoiners, right? To see that there is hyper-Bitcoinization and that people have this option, this alternative option to the fiat money that we have now that's completely destroying everything, because only a certain amount of people are in charge of it. No one's in charge of Bitcoin. So, you know, that's why we preach that as early as you can, you know. It's not so that you pump our bags, it's so that you can start having this opportunity in your life as well, mm-hmm. this power in your life as well. The earlier you're in, the better, and this is just how it is with every single thing that we adopt in the world.
Mm-hmm. And my view on this is also that the premise is flawed of the question, because if we have hyper-Bitcoinization, if the price is at $5 million, that necessarily means that it's adopted much more than it is currently, and a lot of people are involved, not only 10% of the people. So to reach that point is where we want to be, and probably will be the opposite. It will be 90% of the people will have will be involved in some form with Bitcoin. And the other part is, let's say that the price reaches $5 million in the future, and if it's stable there or whatever happens to the price, then it's the same thing as now. Now it's $40,000. So some people buy it, some people don't. It will be the same thing at $5 million or $1 billion. You know, some people will buy a few Satoshis, some people won't, and people will transact. So the price level doesn't really matter. But if it grows to that point, it means that a lot of people are involved, not only 10%. That's my view on it.
Absolutely.
Let me bring one question about community. Well, Bitcoin is a worldwide thing, right? So it's free for all. Anybody can participate. In most countries in the world, I'm sure that every country in the world, maybe not North Korea. Well, maybe they do too. Actually, they do. Yes, everybody's involved. So what do you guys feel about community, especially talking about languages? Because most of the communication in Bitcoin happens in English, is like the standard language for business and for Bitcoin as well. But for myself, for example, when I want to find out more, research something, I research in English because most of the content is in English. But this is changing, right? And we're talking about Latin America here. Spanish has become a very important language for Bitcoin content and community and discussions. And the same thing for other countries, other languages. So how is this evolving, and how important is this for the development of Bitcoin towards hyper-Bitcoinization?
I think that 2021 was the Bitcoin Español year, like Bitcoin in Spanish, el año de Bitcoin en Español, because when you started to see a country that is adopting Bitcoin as a legal tender, it gains a lot of traction just because the conversation is happening in a Spanish-speaking country. And then you see all these new wave of interests of different Bitcoiners around the world learning Spanish, because they feel that they are losing some kind of message that is better understand if you are at least a good Spanish speaker. So it is important to have this kind of discussion in our own languages, because I'm not a fluent English speaker, and you see that we can lose some kind of things in the discussions, but when you are talking in your own language and in Spanish, we also have a very specific slang in each of all different countries. You will talk Latam Spanish. It is really difficult to do that. So it is important to have these little things to better explain Bitcoin to the people that is trying to learn it. So it is really important to always have this kind of translators all around the world that are trying to give the Bitcoin language, like Cami said, in a space that we hosted last year, to their own language. And yes, the English thing is really cool. I'm really happy to discuss in English, but also seeing that people is doing the effort to make this idea go through their own language is really important in terms of adoption, in terms of building community, because it is not the same. Even it is the best gringo in the world, the most heard, the most lovely gringo in all the world, it is not the same as people talking me in Spanish about Bitcoin, explaining the doubts that I may have. And I think that even those that are trying to learn Spanish to connect with the Spanish-speaking community or are trying to make that effort will find that the same things that we found years ago. Like, I feel kind of excluded sometimes because I can't understand the whole jokes or something like that. But it is all part of the same thing, like trying to learn Bitcoin, trying to explain it in a more clear way. it is really important to have it in your own language for sure.
Yeah, I think there's just so much untapped potential that we have not even scratched the surface of when it comes to the communities that are going to be built in the, and I speak for the Spanish-speaking communities because that's where Javier and I are interacting. How do we know that there's not a Michael Saylor in the Spanish language, you know, or a Breedlove or a Nick Carter or all these other brilliant minds? How do we know that they don't also exist in the Spanish-speaking world? We're not going to find out if we don't have these conversations in Spanish. So I think it's super important for us as Spanish speakers to start having these conversations in our own languages, for people that are bilingual to kind of cater to both sides of the spectrum, because we still haven't reached a huge group of people that can have very rich conversations like the ones we have in the English language. So we're still very early on, but it's super excited to find out, you know, who these people are going to be, how enriching these conversations are going to be, and how we can connect with our own communities, because we have a very different perspective than the people here that just live in the United States. And I feel like those different perspectives can definitely bring so much value to Bitcoin as a whole. It just makes everything so much more rich.
And also, I think that a really interesting idea, and it is something that Camille said in that space that I mentioned before, we all talk the Bitcoin language, that we all want to achieve more freedom. We all are trying to teach others how they can build their own freedoms. And in the end of the day, it is really important to explain those ideas in a very clear way. Like, if you don't understand English, it doesn't mean that you will be excluded of Bitcoin. There will be a really brilliant Spanish speaker to explain you in your own language.
Yeah, Bitcoin, we all speak one language, and that's Bitcoin.